While the unprecedented global crisis has put the education technology space in the spotlight like never before, educational institutions in over 107 countries have closed down, disarming over 860 million students, according to Barclays. In India, too, the story is no different. With schools shutting, learning has moved online, literally at the click of a pen. India's already buzzing edutech space is now reporting a huge surge in usage and engagement that promises to lead to record revenues during the lockdown. One company that saw the billion-dollar opportunity in the online education space early was Byju's. What started in 2008 as a vision to help students fall in love with learning is now the world's most valuable education technology company. Teacher turned entrepreneur Byju Ravindran successfully used technology to reach out to the K-12 segment of students across the country, and now his eponymous app has over 50 million downloads with 3.5 million paid subscribers. And as some of the top most global investors line up to own a piece of India's edutech pie, Byju's has proven that there is no business like the education business. Hello, welcome to Young Turks, India's longest running show on startups and entrepreneurship. I'm Shireen Bhan. Today's show, we're calling it a masterclass on the education business in India. And joining me for this special are two gentlemen who understand this business and its ins and outs. Byju Ravindran, the founder and CEO of Byju's, and Sandeep Naik, the managing director India and Southeast Asia, General Atlantic, a big supporter of edtech companies globally and an investor in Byju since 2018. In fact, Sandeep is also an investor in unacademy.com. Gentlemen, appreciate you joining us here on the program. Byju, let me come to you. You know, you placed this bet in 2008, well before edutech was legitimized or was in fact the buzzword or sexy. Now, given what we've seen happen through this COVID times, this model is now being looked at with a lot more seriousness. Investors are considering this as the next big opportunity. Tell me about what this COVID time has told you about the strength of the model and where it could lead you.
Yeah, we were always convinced about how technology can be used to enable and solve all the large scale problems which we have, not just in India, but most of the emerging markets, which when you look at the big challenges in education, right, there's a core sector, an important sector, whether it's access to teachers, I'm not even using the word good teachers, or whether it's the format of learning, which is driven by fear of exams, where students just memorize, replicate, forget, or whether it's personalization, which is even in the classroom of 20 students, it's impossible for a teacher to personalize. So these three core challenges, now solving it in the physical world by building schools and by having enough teachers inside classrooms, it's almost impossible because we already have a very suboptimal teacher-student ratio of 1:35. That's where using smartphones and using apps and by creating content in a format which students respond to, offered through devices which they are friendly with. Because if you look at the current generation, they are digital natives. It's, now, contrary to what people think, you can get to their, increase their attention span provided you get the format right. So we see, what we have seen in the last few weeks is that 6 to 9 year olds, their completion rates are, you'll be surprised to know that is as good or better than 15 to 17 year olds. The only reason can be that 10 year is a huge gap. And the next generation, they are, for them, spending time on a screen is almost a primary habit. So, but the biggest behavior change or a huge shift in behavior is what you can see in the other stakeholders, whether it's teachers getting used to using online learning or teaching tools, or parents accepting this as even more of a mainstream format. Maybe because they don't have an option today, but it's here to stay. When I say it's here to stay, I expect on the other side of the crisis, it's not that it'll stay 100% online, neither it'll go 100% offline, but it's every time the good things happen in the middle. It's never about two extremes. And hopefully we will end up, every crisis presents an opportunity. And this is that inflection point for education and some of the other core sectors where technology was always finding it difficult to disrupt, positively disrupt. So we'll end up with a blended model which will combine hopefully the best of both, because there are some things which can never be done online, and there are a lot of things which can always be done better online. So yeah, looking forward to it.
Yeah, you know, several important issues that you've raised there, and I like the fact that that you talk about this being the inflection point as far as the edutech business is concerned. And you're right that, you know, today you're seeing an almost 3x increase in the number of users. Students are spending about 100 minutes per day. That's the kind of engagement that you've seen versus 71 minutes per day previously. So as you rightly pointed out, perhaps this kind of engagement may not be sustainable post the lockdown lifting. But it does open up a big opportunity. Now, can you explain to me a little bit more on what this blended offering is likely to be, what shape, size, form it's likely to take?
So if you ask me the future of learning, right, there are two things to it. On one, how you offer it. Second, how the students are going to consume or receive it, right? Now, offering-wise, if you look at it, that's where I use the word blended model. The teachers who are getting used to the benefits of online learning. And they're also, on the flip side of it, we also run the risk of some of the teachers, a lot of institutions, just looking at online learning as a crisis management tool. There we run the risk of them getting exposed to suboptimal models of online learning. When I say suboptimal models, it's like, because when you do things like really fast and keeping short term in mind, chances are that you won't see the, because it's not that all online learning are equal, right? There are like, because it's what has taken years for us to develop and which got evolved into a model which is liked by the students. You can't replicate that in a matter of few days or few months, because a lot of teachers are struggling to get used to it, but I'm sure it's just a matter of time before they become better at it. And then the real blended model will be an asynchronous format of learning where students will have an option of learning what flexibility to learn what they want, when they want, how many ever times they want, combined with the synchronous model where they interact with teachers, interact with other students online or offline, because as I mentioned, there are some things which can only be done offline. Now, all these hard skills like math, science, coding, I strongly believe that to impart that knowledge, online is a very powerful medium. When I say online or digital, it's not just about online and live, it's about using technology or leverage technology to create all the new age formats which gets the attention of the students, whether it's movie like videos or game like interactions. Now, the synchronous format is also important to have that discipline or that schedule in learning. And the combination of both is what I meant by a blended model. Now, the advantage is like on the online side of it, what most of the people don't realize is a personal screen like this is not necessarily distraction most of the times. It's the other way around. It's almost like, I use the word, every student has a front row seat now. So like in a classroom of 30, 35, there are backbenchers and they can hide here. I'm using the word positively. Students can see the screen properly. They can actually focus on what's happening and on the screen and where it matters. So, and that might be the reason why we see high engagement and very few drop-offs even in lower grades. And on the other side, now behavior-wise, teachers getting used to it, parents accepting it better, students obviously were always early adopters, but all stakeholders accepting the format will help us to go more mainstream. When I say us, I'm talking about online learning, not as a replacement of the school system. It's never a replacement. It's actually a good complement, because what cannot be done online effectively is all the, again, very important life skills, now soft skills. I always talk about the most important skill being empathy, right? You can't do, like, you need to interact. And now there are people who talk about even the interactions in person can be done digitally or on online. And to some extent, it's true, because maybe that's why a lot of journalists like you, it's like more than a crisis, you are using it as an opportunity to talk to like whoever you want across the world and bringing them to the Indian audience, right? So, yeah, so there is this
Yes, that's certainly what we're hoping to do. But I like what you said, that, you know, this is now giving every student an opportunity to get a front row seat. I think that's nicely put there. But let me get Sandeep into the conversation. And Sandeep, you know, there's so much conversation right now on what the post-COVID world will look like. Will everything dramatically change and so on and so forth? I think if I were to pick up on what Baiju's has just said, What has happened during this COVID crisis is that there has been an acceleration, and in some cases, an exponential acceleration of a trend that was already, something that the world was dealing with. EduTech was already around, as Byju's has told us, since 2008, but this has given it an exponential acceleration. Do you believe that this is likely to happen across a bunch of other sectors as well? EduTech is just one of them.
Absolutely, Shireen. You know, you've been aware of my passion around education technology, the reason why we've made multiple bets in this segment, including Byju's, Unacademy, and globally as well with investments like Duolingo, Arco, Hotmart, Open Classroom. So we have been a huge supporter of education technology because we have strong conviction around the digitization of education to democratize access to quality educational content. And we have supported entrepreneurs all over the world. Byju is one of the most successful entrepreneurs that we have backed. But when it comes to crisis, you know, time is a great teacher, but unfortunately it kills all its pupils. You know, French composer Hector Berlioz had mentioned that, you know, when a crisis hits you, you cannot just sit around and not adopt to the new normal. These kinds of recession shocks accelerate massive shifts. And this particular shock is sufficiently large that in many areas, you will overcome the natural inertia, Shireen, that you talked about, that resided in systems and people, and accelerate change that was already underway. So behaviors and adoption have been accelerated by almost 4 to 5 years that it would have normally taken to a span of 3 to 6 months. Yeah. And this would be a catalyst for positive change in terms of efficiencies, inclusion, as well as overcoming the physical barriers. You're seeing a generation above us, right? The older people coming online. You're seeing people who never thought that they would go online for quality of service or for convenience, being forced to adopt to online technologies versus the consumers that just chased deep discounts and values. And what we are seeing has been a great boon. Shireen, you know that I've been a conservative when it came to consumer technology investments, and I've stayed away from it, barring educational technology, which I believe is one segment where people would actually pay to get the best content and best service. But I have, post-crisis, become a big bull in terms of consumer technology companies, because all these consumer technology companies that were burning huge amounts of capital to acquire the customers, to get them to understand what their apps do, and then get their behavior changed, has completely been shrunk. So to answer your question, there are going to be changes across the board. This is going to cut across many segments of consumer technology, be it online grocery delivery, food delivery, digital fitness, telehealth, education technology, and I can go on and on because we are exploring across all of these segments to back phenomenal entrepreneurs that will build, as I keep mentioning, the Bharat of India, and backing the real consumers that can benefit from this trend.
You know, I want to talk about the Bharat and developing for Bharat with both you and Byju, but let me just talk about what you told me just now, that you've now become the big bull of consumer tech, and that's largely because of this easy migration, so to speak, that you envisage because of the COVID times that we live in, and customer acquisition is perhaps going to be easier and will involve less cash burn. But does that also mean that you are going to see the fittest and the strongest at this point in time survive? And what will you then place your bets on?
You're absolutely right. You know, in crisis, the stronger gets the stronger come out strongest, and the fittest and the best entrepreneurs who focus on a single thing and put their head down and execute will win. So fortunately, we made a few bets in companies pre-crisis. So what we're currently doing is we are looking at consolidating the space in investments that we have already made, because in these crises, many of your competitors, many of the companies in your adjacent sectors are going to have a very tough time. Mm. And if you have backed the best entrepreneur and you have backed the best company and you have the capital to really help them consolidate the market, those are the opportunities that are high priority opportunities for us right now, Shireen. Secondly, because of this change, there are going to be new companies that didn't get the time of the day before that will really come into their own going forward. And by that, I mean, if you think about telehealth, it's been around for a while, but nobody ever thought that you could consult a doctor over a video conference call and actually get 90 to 95% of the medical advice. and still go on with life. And people are just now forced to do that. People have gotten comfortable doing that. People are seeing the benefits of that. Similarly, digital fitness, you're going to see a lot of the fitness models move over to the digital side. And as people adjust to the new normal, they are finding the new normal much more efficient than the previous one.
In fact, we had Mukesh Bansal of CureFit yesterday talking about making that digital pivot as far as CureFit is concerned. But Baiju, let me come back to the point that was being made there by Sandeep on this building for Bharat. And now, as you look at the next phase as far as expansion is concerned, how will you do that? For instance, even during this COVID time, there has been constraints for people who may have only a single screen or a single smartphone at home, may not have the income to be able to get a smartphone or a laptop and make that available for the children at home. So, one, of course, is that constraint. But otherwise, what is the plan as far as expansion is concerned, regional languages? What are you looking at to build for Bharat?
For the Bharat which you are mentioning, I always say that there is always a challenge of digital divide, which is what you're mentioning in terms of what about students who are not even having access to, like, forget about one screen, but where they don't have access to any screen, right? Because I've seen reports where the number is around 70-75% of the students have access to a smartphone. So solving for digital divide is still going to be a challenge, especially like if you want to make sure that all of them have access to education, because that's solving for access is the first challenge, and then improving the efficiency on what you offer through that access is the second challenge. Now, is there a short-term solution for how do you take care of this digital divide, which is talked about everywhere, not just in India, where the students who are going to a good school, having access to good teachers, they also have access to a device. But what I was trying to tell in my previous point itself is that solving this in the physical world is almost an impossible challenge. Our best bet to solve these challenges at scale is when we can use technology as an enabler, use this smartphones or the screen distribution, if I can use that word, and making sure that more and more are getting used to learning from this, right? So coming back to this digital divide, right? And how do we take care of, obviously, if you divide this into this a top one third, those who are having access to like so-called good schools and good teachers, they will adopt to these methods fast because they'll use this for learning at home. And the next one third, that's where creating the product in multiple languages, having a subsidized model. So we have just launched our app in almost all languages. There are 2-3 remaining which will go live in the next 2-3 weeks. So in the last 3-4 weeks, or like if you see the app now, you have an option of, I don't want to use this as a marketing medium, but I'm just still mentioning because this will help possibly the next one third to have access to the product in like English as well as in that language, because you need to understand that India is very aspirational. Like I've gone to Malayalam medium school, but even then I was figuring out my own ways of learning the average English, which I am speaking here, as I'm sure, I don't know, like maybe you'll struggle to understand if I speak fast, is what I've learned by listening to cricket commentary on radio. So our students are very aspirational. So if you give them even now, like some kind of access, they will learn how to make the best use of it. So, and for the bottom one third, that's where we have the biggest challenge. How do we solve for that last mile? That's where we need the policymakers, we need the NGOs to come, because we are, even if the intention is there for us, and there's a strong intention, because I come from that kind of a background. And it's like all our investors also will support me to have a perfectly balanced for-profit model and not-for-profit model for that bottom one-third. But the challenge is, how do you actually reach out to them? And that's, you can't solve that in the short term. Not, obviously not during this crisis, but what I expect is over the next 3-4 years, with the kind of digital adoption which is happening with Jio and more smartphone penetration and internet penetration, that's going to get solved anyway in the next 2-3 years. And then you have a very, very good chance of making sure that we solve the problem of access. And on top of that, like, it's not just we are solving access, but we are also solving, like, how do you make it efficient, right? And I always tell that in a digital format, you have, I use normal, lot of analogies, but here I use the word a chocolate-covered broccoli. So you can actually present the content in a format which gets students' attention before we take them through the the rigor which is required in learning, because it's not like entertainment. Entertainment, you only need to get engagement from students. But when it comes to education, you need to get engagement, but eventually you need to show effectiveness. Or unless and until parents see the benefit, students see the benefit, they're not going to continue with you. So.
Well, that's a good trick. A chocolate-covered broccoli is a good trick, and I think every parent probably has used it at some point or the other. But I want to pick up on the point that Sandeep was making and get you to share your learnings with us, Baiju, because I think this is important for a lot of people who are trying to make this digital pivot at this point in time and monetize it. I mean, I gave the example of CureFit, and yesterday trying to explain the plan B, which is to go digital. Now, you turned profitable, Baiju's turned profitable in FY 18-19, revenue of about 2,800 crore rupees in FY 19-20. So what are the challenges as you went about monetizing content, and what would your playbook be to those who are looking at monetizing this digital pivot?
Is the question to me?
Yes.
Okay, so the monetization, like almost from the beginning, because I started this business, obviously I never started this as a business, right? It's a clear case example of your passion intersecting with a clear need and figuring out ways to improve, how to make it bigger and better. And that's where continuously striving to do that. Now, monetization was important for us from the beginning because I didn't start this with VC money, right? And like when you met me, I think in 2011, we were just making that shift from test prep to school learning, and we were still doing it offline. So it was important to figure out the right balance between creating free users and monetizing some of them by showing them a freemium model. Even in the offline world, we actually had a freemium model. So the advantages of any freemium model is if you have a strong product, and obviously you also need to make sure that there's a clear product market fit, then monetization as it has never been a challenge for us, to be very frank. So in the offline world, our freemium model was first session was free, our second session will be free, more students will talk about it. So what started off in a classroom, when I met you, it was in an auditorium, and then it went on to become even bigger, where at its peak in the offline, on those sessions, there used to be 25,000 students attending those math workshops, math sessions simultaneously. And then we made make sure that the impact is, like we are able to reach out to from thousands to millions. That's when the ecosystem, like the digital infrastructure, was just getting shaped up. We moved from an offline, 100% offline services model to 100% online product-based approach. Still, even in that product-based approach, our sales model was offline for the first 4 years. Now, after the crisis, like we were forced to move our sales offline sales to online sales. So we've learned how you can make it even more efficient. So on the other side of the crisis, we'll have a even more productive workforce, because they're also, they're going to use the best of both, what can be done offline and what can be done online. So monetization in any segment, right? And this is a segment where parents, if they see benefit, right? And they are used to spending on education. Obviously in India, in India, education is still the only way to make it big. If parents see clear value in it, that's why having a freemium model, and that's what we have always followed. We give parents and students an opportunity to explore, use the application for a few days, few weeks, few months, and then we convert them to a premium model. And the best part, out of all, like you mentioned, a lot of boring business numbers, but what we're very happy about is the fact that we were able to get the kind of engagement initially, like previously before the crisis, more than an hour on a daily basis from the students. And then now, even more, that's an indication of engagement. It's an indication that students love it, but that alone is not enough. A biggest real long-term validation of the product is the fact that 85% of the students, they continued from last year to this year. Mm. And for parents to spend again, they need to see clear benefits. Otherwise, if it's not resulting in I'll say improvement of learning, like parents will easily drop out. So
yeah. You're right about that. I think a lot of people would like to have the kind of boring numbers that you just spoke of, Baiju. And you know, you're right about the fact that we first did something together in 2011. That's how long, you know, this show has been around longer, in fact. And Sandeep, let me put the same question to you. You know, what are you telling your portfolio companies, you know, in terms of what they must keep in mind at this point in time, given the fact that this is an uncertain period, it's likely to be an uncertain period for a while. Runways for everybody might be different depending on how much they've been able to raise. What's the playbook?
You know, let me just also go back to what the question you asked, Baiju. You never start thinking about a business model by saying how I'm going to monetize this and what would profitability look like. And I've maintained this for quite some time, that if you address a real need of Bharat, if you go after what the consumer really needs to improve either their life or move out of a social strata that they have, the consumers will pay for it. And consistently, it's been proven that people that really go and focus on tech and singularly execute on that aspect, these are the companies that have turned profitable. These are the companies that are scaling very, very quickly. In fact, Baiju and I have this conversation all the time. We sit and we talk about what more can you give to the same consumer at the same price point? And the chat is never around how can we monetize the consumer more, what kind of profit pool can we go after? And I think, Shireen, that's the big message, right? Is if entrepreneurs really focus on the real needs of the big belly of the consumer base of India, which is the real Bharat, you will build successful businesses. To answer the second question that you asked, in terms of prices, I think what's going to really happen, which makes life easy for investors like us, is you're going to quickly start seeing the wartime CEO or the true entrepreneur from the ones that were fly-by-night entrepreneurs who said, oh, it's a great time to start a startup business, so let's go ahead and also do that because there's capital in plenty. And I'm sure that we can continue to burn capital on business models that don't have sustainable unit economics, and we can keep raising money at higher valuations. I think that game is over. This crisis is really going to separate the strong entrepreneurs like Baiju's of the world from the ones that probably would have never built a sustainable business. And all we need to do as investors is identify people like Baiju who have a very strong passion, who are doing something that is really building the belly of the market, that is really building the next generation of Bharat, and then back them with capital and be there at times to give them the right advice so that they singularly focus on the goal that they started off with. As long as you do that, our startup ecosystem, our consumer tech ecosystem is going to really flourish, which is why I'm a big bull right
now. Sandeep, given the fact that you're a big bull on consumer tech at this point, are you? I'm coming to you, Baiju, in just a second. Are you going to be putting down money even during this phase? Or what's the plan looking like as far as investments?
Absolutely, Shireen. You know, this is the time you step up, because I've always believed that you don't react to a crisis because that leads to panic. You respond to a crisis because that's when you make thoughtful, deliberate decisions. This is the time when true value-added long-term investors like us need to step up and back the best entrepreneurs in the segments to help them with their passion of scaling very large tens of billions of dollars of consumer tech companies. And I have no doubt in my mind, this is based on now almost two decades of investing, that the time has come. This is consumer tech 2.0, and we're going to see global companies coming out of India that will be addressing specific needs of emerging markets.
So you talked about backing wartime CEOs, Sandeep. What's your war chest looking like to back these consumer tech companies that you believe could be global players in the time to come?
You know, globally, Shireen, we have about $10 billion of dry powder right now. We think that the next 2 years will be the best vintage to make these investments, because this is the time that you can go in and invest behind entrepreneurs and help them scale their companies. And so in terms of deployment in India, I'm very bullish that we will be deploying at least $1 billion to $1.5 billion in the next year to two, for sure. This will be our largest deployment year over the next 2 years, specifically backing innovative digital disruptors that will build the Bharat of.
Okay, $1 billion to $1.5 billion to be invested in India over the next year or so. That's the big bet coming in there from General Atlantic. Baijus, I'll give you the final say on the program. Are you going to be out there looking for funding? Any need for it at this point in time? And what is a wartime CEO like you focusing on today?
I always believe it's for startups, you always need wartime CEOs, not just during a crisis. Because pandemic or no pandemic, startups are always about doing things on first principles. Having an annual plan is important, but having a weekly plan and sometimes even a daily plan is the order of the day. And I strongly feel it's not just the big startups, but this is an opportunity for a lot of new entrepreneurs to come and solve for multitude of challenges or problems which are thrown by this crisis, right? Because startups launched during a crisis or during a downturn tend to be far more durable and resilient than those started in a better economic state. And since every crisis creates this multiple challenges, there are enough problems to be solved. So that means there will be enough opportunities for new ideas. After the last financial crisis, in the immediate years, there were more than 50 unicorns created globally. It's important to keep in mind that you're actually solving something which is close to you. So you need to find a problem which you care about so that you don't stop when you hit the first roadblock. And that's why you need, as Sandeep mentioned, you need players who can score hundreds on the last day on an uneven track, and not just those who can score on hundreds on the first day in a flat wicket. Or if it's about football, you need teams who can go and win in away grounds under a hostile crowd.
Well, it looks like at this point in time, the two of you have clearly, hit it right out of the park. And we wish you the very best of luck. Baiju and Sandeep, thanks very much for joining us here on the CNBC TV 18 special, sharing your thoughts on education and what this sector could look like in the years to come, as well as what consumer tech in India could look like post the COVID times. We'll take a quick break, but don't go anywhere. You're watching Young Turks. We're back in a moment.
यार मेरे कजन की वजह से ना पूरे